Okay, the first question is just consisting of exercises about the natural world, since people often work with the walls when we maximize utility and that kind of thing. Can you see the answer key? Is that easier to see? I tripped up the font type to 15 points. All right, so in the first problem, we are to find the natural log for A, the square root of A times B to the power of zero, and the formulas are well known. The only thing to bear in mind is that b to the power of zero is equal to one, and the natural log of one is zero. I'll go to the whiteboard to make this clearer. So any constant, finite constant, like E, taken to the power of zero, will give us one. So we can write that the natural log of one is equal to zero in this case. So in the first problem, although B is non-zero, it is taken to the power of zero, and so the natural log here will drop out, since the zero times the natural log of B. And the second problem, hello, your John, can you hear me?
Hello, sir, yeah.
Okay, good. I can hear you as well. So I'm going through problems on the answer key for the sample midterm. I sent you the answer key of today by email. So if there are any problems that you would want me to concentrate on, by all means, raise them now. And then I will give you the actual midterm after class tonight. In the case of B times A, all taken to the power of minus one, we have minus natural log of B minus the natural log of A. So the answer is clear as long as you bear in mind that we have a power of minus one for the product of BA. And then, as we discussed a few minutes ago, the natural log of one has got to be zero, since any constant, including E, taken to the power of zero is equal to one. So no problem there, I hope. And then finally, the natural log of zero is not really defined, but if we take the power of V to negative infinity, we get closer and closer to zero. And then, if you would like for extra credit, you can show that the natural log of this product, A to the power of B times C to the power of D, can be separated into B times the natural log of A and D to the natural log of C. if that's easier for you to see now. So we have, by definition of a natural law, that A is equal to E to the power of the natural law of A, and likewise for B. So the product AB, if we take the transform, is just E to the natural law of A times E to the natural law of B. And then by the properties of the exponents, you can add natural log of A plus natural log of B. So in particular, if we set B equal to A, then A squared is equal to E to the power of the natural log of A plus the natural log of A, or E to the power of 2 plus natural log of A. Or if we are repeating A B times, then A to the power of B is A to the power of B to the natural log of A. And that's about all that there is to the proof. So now take a look at the product of A to the power of B times C to the power of D. And we bought the natural log in that case. So let's try a solution where H is equal to B times the natural log of A plus B times the natural log of C. Well, we've already shown that A to the power of B has a natural log of B times the natural log of A. So if we take our trial solution H and plug it in for the power of E, we had E to the power of B times the natural log of A times E to the power of D times the natural log of C, or the product that we began with in determining the natural log. So the trial solution works in that case. Kind of an informal proof, but it's just extra credit, that's all. Okay, so let's move on now to the economics problems, beginning with this Lagrangian. How is that? Can you see that more easily? We've gone through the Lagrangian lectures before, but if you have questions, I'm happy to go through it again. The original utility function, the square root of a times of x times y, is rather messy to work with. So what I suggest is that you replace that original utility function with the natural log, in this case, the natural log of the square root of the product xy of this. This will give us the same answer as the original utility function, because the log function is a positive monotonic transformation of xy. So now we have a Lagrangian with a log linear utility function at the beginning, and then we add the Lagrangian budget constraint that if you take the derivative of L with respect to lambda, we will automatically satisfy the budget constraint. Okay, so let's take a look at the derivative of L with respect to X. We have 1/2 times the change in the natural log of X with respect to X, the derivative. As you know, that derivative is 1/X. So in the first term, the derivative of L with respect to X is just 1/2X. And then with respect to the Bessel constraint, the change in L with respect to X is just minus lambda times the place of X. Okay, so far. So what about the natural log of Y in this case? The problem is symmetrical. The derivative of L with respect to Y is 1/2 a constant times the derivative of the natural log of Y with respect to Y. So that gives us 1/2Y, and then the change due to Y in the Bessel constraint. So let's see what we have now. But going to the whiteboard for a second. And I think I can get rid of this. All right, so we saw that the derivative with respect to X gives us 1/2X. Minus, I don't have the Greek character lambda, so we use A instead, times the place of X all equal to zero. And so 1/2 times X is equal to A times the place of X, which I've added to both sides. And so we can solve for A by dividing through by the place of X. And we will see in a moment why this is useful. And the same thing now for the derivative with respect to Y, 1/2Y minus A times the place of Y equal to zero. And then if we solve that problem for A, we have 1/2 times the place of Y equal to A. Okay, so far. So the natural thing to do is to get rid of A by equating the two transformations of the derivative. So we have 1/2 times spending on X equal to 1/2 times spending on Y. Let's take inversions. 2 times the spending on X is equal to 2 times spending on Y. Cancel 2, and we have the remarkable result that spending on X will, in optimality, equal spending on Y. So that's a bit of progress, but you don't just have a Michelin demand function to either X or Y. You remember that in the Michelin demand function, X, for example, depends on the prices of both goods and on income as well. So what is our next step in this case? How can we now get Michelin demand function? Let's use a third condition for optimality using the lambda parameter that I'm calling A here. And this is the budget constraint. You remember that the budget constraint is a coefficient of lambda in the original problem. So we have in the budget constraint M, which is income, minus spending on X and Y. For optimality, the derivative has got to equal 0. So now, to derive the demand function for X, we can get rid of spending on Y. This theory equals all spending out of income that does not go to X. So now let's take that condition and replace it in the right hand side of the equation right here. So the spending on Y is equal to M minus spending on X. Let's gather terms. And then solve for X by dividing through by 2 times the price of X. And there you have it. A sensible demand function, X falls as the price of X rises. And what about the impact of M on X? What happens when income rises? What happens to X in this case? Of course, X will rise. So what would you anticipate is the demand function for Y in this case, given the symmetry of X and Y in the utility function?
Isn't it the same?
Yeah, or M over divided two. By 2 yeah. times. What's next?
Wait a second. Okay. 2PY?
Yeah. And if you wish, we can double check that. We have the spending on Y is equal to spending on X. And and the spending on X, keep X as the component. Because our solution for X, which is M over 2, times the price of X. Or M over 2. So let me restate this to make it easier to see. And now, we can solve for y by dividing through by the price of y, or m divided by 2 times the price of y, which we want to show. Okay, so far. So this brings us now to the indirect utility function. And what is that? a bit of economies. But the concept is very simple. After we maximize utility, given the prices and income, we will achieve a particular value. The value of maximized utility is represented by the indirect utility function. To arrive at the indirect utility most easily, it's a good idea to go back to the original utility function. The square root of x and y, right here. Since we will get the same our solution, whether we use the square root function or the log of the square root function. So D is maximized utility. We generate the maximum utility by solving for the demand functions X and Y. So you remember that the whole idea was to find the values of x and y as those of functions that maximize utility. So here's our Marshallian demand function for x. Depends on prices and income. And the same thing for y as well. So the first product, the demand function for X, is just income I divided by 2 times the price of X, and the same idea for Y. So let's go to the whiteboard. D is equal to the function for x, I divided by 2 times the price of x. All of that times I divided by 2 times the price of y. And then we will put all of this under the square root radical. So we have income squared divided by 4 times the price of x times the price of y. Okay, so far. So how can we simplify our notation now? So clearly, our squared, taken as a square root, will just give us bad I. And then this, the square root of 4 is 2. And then finally, we have the product of x and y still under the vertical. And there is our indirect utility function. Okay, so far. So, note that indirect utility is very different from an ordinary utility function. Our ordinary utility function depends on products x and y. But v depends on prices as well as income. And it's very useful to use in cost-benefit analysis, for example, because it gives us an exact value for either a policy that is positive to people, or the cost that occurs because of a negative program. So for example, Kazakhstan back in 2007 or so was thinking about whether to change the tax structure of the country. One policy proposal was to increase the sales tax. The tax amounts to an increase in the price material of X. Just think about how costly a tax increase can be for people. Let's calculate V for the original world tax, and then recalculate it for the new high price of X due to the tax, and then compare the two things. So that's the idea in problem number 3 here. Okay, so the values of X and Y given the prices are easy to understand, but what about the indirect utility? What is it worth in this case? So D is equal to I, which is 8, you know, problem $8, divided by 2 times the square root of the product of x and y. And what is that? The price of x is 1, the price of y is 4. So we take 4 to the square root. All of this in the denominator, or we have 8 divided by 4, 2 times 2, and there is the value of V. Okay. Now the government decides to tax X by $1. So the post-tax price of X has increased to $2. Our problem now is to recalculate the value of X using our Michelin demand function. Okay, so far. So X now equals income, $8, divided by 2 times the new price of X, which is $2. And therefore, X is dropping to 2. Originally, it had been 4. Now, let's recalculate indirect utility, the maximum value of utility given prices and income. So, indirect utility is income divided by in the denominator 2 times the radical of price of X times the price of Y. The price of X now is $2. So V is equal to 8 divided by them, divided by 2 times 8, since the new price of X is 2 and the price of Y is 4. We have that V has fallen to the square root of 2 in this case. I'll go to the whiteboard, maybe this would be clearer there. So B is equal to income, which is 8, and then divided by 4 times the square root of 2. So all of this is in the denominator. We have 2 divided by the square root of 2, and what is that? Of course, 2 to the power of 0.5, or just about 1.414 in that region. Okay, so far. Is the calculation of V clear? So all we have to do is to plug in income and prices. But this is rather strange. The tax has cut our utility rather dramatically from 2 units down to 1.4, even though our nominal income remains at $8. So what's going on? Why do we have such a steep decrease in utility? So the answer is that the tax affects us in a couple of ways. We have higher prices for goods now, so even though our nominal income has not changed, our real income in terms of X and Y that we can buy has decreased. So as our purchases decrease, the utility will fall as well. That's the basic idea. And then finally, a question for extra credit. Why is it the case that the tax on X does not affect our purchases of Y? After all, we have a fall in real income, so you would think that our feasible purchases of X and Y will fall as well. X does indeed fall from 4 to 2, but Y does not change. Y remains at 1. Why? But you knew. Well, the answer is in the functions that we had calculated for X and Y. Notice that Y depends only on nominal income and the price of Y. It does not depend on the price of X. So even though we are poorer than before, we continue to buy the same amount of Y as before. This utility function is separable in X and Y. The price of X does not affect Y, and the price of Y does not affect X. Basically, that's it. And I think that covers all the problems on the sample midterm. Questions?
When is the midterm exam?
I will give it to you tonight. After we finish class, I will email it to you.
When is it due?
Friday at 8 o'clock. Friday at 8 p.m. Is that convenient for you? If not, I can take the midterm, let's say for Sunday noon.
No, it's fine. Friday night. Can we do at 9 p.m. because I'm flying back.
Okay, 9 p.m. Friday. April, okay. Is that fine with you? Okay. We have just a couple of minutes remaining for talking about expenditure functions, which are even more useful than indirect utility. So an example of how we can use expenditure functions is from environmental economics. We can calculate the cost of lung disease in Almaty. And there's an example. So you already know what indirect utility is, the maximum value that we can achieve given our income. And the expenditure function is just the dual function related to indirect utility. We can think about maximizing utility, or you can think about minimizing spending that will achieve that level of utility that be maximized. That's the idea behind the expenditure function. And then how we can use it in a multi for air pollution. All right, so we already uncovered the Michelian demand functions to X and Y, and then we substituted those functions back into the original utility function to arrive at indirect utility. So that's fine. And there is indirect utility for the Cobb-Douglas utility function. For right now, we won't need the general case. People said alpha and beta, the powers of X and Y equal to 1/2. And there is the rationale for expenditures. All right, so we know that D is maximized utility given our income I. So we are spending our income very efficiently, no money wasted. That means that we can think of I as the minimal amount that we have to spend in order to achieve the value of D. In our example from the midterm, for example, B was equal to 2. Very easy to derive the expenditure function. All that we did was to take the indirect utility function and then solve for I. And there it is. So let's try a numerical example of the expenditure function. Of beta and alpha are the powers of X and Y in the original utility function. We have already derived the values of X and Y to maximize utility, and we have calculated the indirect utility equal to 2. So now, here is the expenditure function, E, equal to 2 times indirect utility times the square root of X and Y. So plugging in our values, expenditures are equal to 8 bills. This is not surprising, since we had spent $8 to maximize utility. Okay, so we can use the expenditure function to calculate in tenge or dollars the social cost of the $1 tax. There is a post-tax price for X. One does not change. Nominal income does not change either. And we've already seen that the utility drops to 1.4 from 2. Okay, so the tax leaves us worse off than before. Before we adopt the tax as a nation, we now want to know how worse off are we going to be because of the tax. After all, if the tax helps us to build more schools and hospitals, it may be justified. But to determine whether it is justified, we've got to have some measure of the social cost. So there it is. We want the expenditures that we must make with the tax on X, then that will enable us to achieve the original level of utility. So how much money will we demand in compensation so that the tax leaves us no worse off than before? In that case, V is not 1.4, but instead equal to 2 in this case. Plug in to D, the original value, 2, before the tax, which is 2, and then calculate. And it turns out that our expenditures under the tax will rise from $8 to $11.20 because of the tax. So the social cost of the tax is $3.20 for a household. With that compensation, we are willing to live with the tax because we can achieve our original level of utility. And there you have it. If we find that the tax increase will build a new research center, to say, that generates $4 in benefits, then the tax is justified. Good luck. And then, finally, there's a puzzle that you can try for extra credit. Whether customers tend to have an income tax or a sales tax. And I will stop there. You will find other examples of expenditure taxes in the PowerPoint slides on indirect utility and expenditure functions. Okay, questions? Are you comfortable with the basic idea behind the expenditure function?
Yeah.
So this is just a way of measuring the true benefits and costs of policies. The tax is damaging because it distorts our decisions of how much X and Y to buy. That's the problem. But the tax may have benefits as well. Other questions about policy identity?
No questions.